collaborator with several of us. We welcome him back to Research Tribune Farm today. Amit is a professor at Ohio Wright State University. Yeah, he's an entrepreneur, he's a researcher, has a lot of students, educator, and currently he's the LexisNexis Eminent Scholar at Wright State University at the Ohio Center of Excellence in Knowledge-Enabled Computing Lab. And his area of research spans across social, sensor, semantic, data, Web 3.0, and all of those areas. And he's very much into building real-world applications in various domains, including healthcare, life sciences, cognitive science, and material sciences, and so on. So it's a pleasure to have Amit here with us today, and several of his students are here at IBM Research. And several of your summer students have worked here with us, so we're glad to have you here, and look forward to your talk.
Thank you very much, Emma. As I was coming in, I saw that conference room, and I remember having a meeting with the Web Fountain. I think this was 2002, if I remember correctly. And we had integrated, at that time, I had started a company in 1999. Initially, it was Tali, then it became Wocket, then it became Simagix. And we had developed this semantic search engine, semantic browsing, semantic advertisement, or sort of semantics-driven targeting and advertisement. We had a patent in 2001. In fact, it had this idea of creating very large knowledge base. We call it in the patent world model and ontology. We call it both. And using that background knowledge, we could improve the search. So the general idea, today you can see that Google knowledge graph or knowledge graph, you know, that's generally the same form of ideas. And Web Fountain had amazingly scalable infrastructure compared to what we had, because we were a startup with 30 people. But the mining was shallow and ours was deeper, you know, understanding of content, so they were complementary and it was very interesting. Of course, we know that business-wise, things change. Again, the Watson things. That brings me to this group of folks. You have some of these guys working for IBM. Meena, Karthik Ramakrishnan, Pablo Mendes. They are, I think Karthik has the car trouble, so he's on his way. And all the three, I think, are in this Watson group. I don't know exact official thing, but I believe that division. And Pratik Jain is at Watson, and then Ning Tan. So those first four are my former advisees. Ning Tan is an advisee, was an advisee of a colleague of mine, Trojan Bank, and he's in the Watson LLP at IBM Austin. Also have Sujan, who is my current student, doing internship here, so it's a wonderful, it's been great synergy working with IBMers. Many of you may not know about Rice University, but I'd like to introduce that to you. We are, you know, not that well-known a university, and yet you might be surprised to see that in the area of World Wide Web, we compete with the best, which is unusual. We are very small. We started web research only in 2007, when I started the Oasis Center, and we've been able to do very impactful work. Maybe that's why you have hired our graduates. I've been blessed with a wonderful research group. These are some of my PhD students. There are some masters and bachelors that are not shown here. And a number of them have helped with the talk that I'm going to be presenting. So I'll be presenting their work. What is interesting about our research group is that we are rather non-traditional academic research group. It may be partly due to kind of where I come from. I was in Honeywell, Unisys when they were in computer business, then Belcore. I've done a couple of startups. Recently, two more startups have come up based on the technology that we have developed. New commercializations happening as we speak. So that entrepreneurship, the large company, commercial product that came from the research, all that, and of course academic stuff, all they have come together. So as I was seeing myself, I noticed that almost everything we do is related to issues of the topics related to things of large impact, human or social development, or other scientific issues that drive. So I tend to pick the topics that have clear impact on the world. Almost all projects, or probably all projects we have real domain partners. What that has led to is this interesting thing here. If I may, so just to give you a sample of the kind of projects we do. This project, so we have domain partners, partners in different domains, and we have access to real data. Everything we do has real data and real world scale data. And it was interesting. I was visiting IBM, I was visiting Park, and when I said I have access to millions of patient records, they said, well, we don't have that. And you know, Sujan there has actually worked on real, you know, patient records. Through the partnership with a company that has taken the work that Sujan and others have done and has resulted in commercial product. It's about computer-assisted coding of ICD-10 and computerized document improvements. That's what those are the products that they have. And then we are able to actually do the research, and of course we publish, but that is not the end for us. And then we create the tool or technology and deploy it. For example, in this case, reducing rehospitalization of chronic heart patients, ADHF, acute decompensated heart failure patients, is a $17 billion a year problem for US healthcare industry. We work with the chief of cardiology medicine at Wexner Medical School at Ohio State University, the guy who has done 100 clinical trials. And our kit gets tested with the real patients that are discharged from the hospital and so on and so forth. I'll talk more about it later on. And recently the president has started this or announced this Material Genome Initiative. Again, we had just recently a workshop. We have people from General Electric, and Pratt & Whitney, and Lockheed Martin, all those guys work on advanced materials, and we get to work with, the, again, real data, deploy our tool between the people who do create advanced material and those OEMs that create, let's say, aircraft wing or things of that nature. So what may be access control, provenance on, and ontologies for material science, but it gets used in this kind of stuff. This is one of the very exciting project. The reason it's exciting is because we've achieved a real impact here also. There were 15 major media articles on this system recently. The last thing was that we worked with one software from this got integrated with Ushahidi. Ushahidi is the most important organization in the world for crisis monitoring and management. And we provide service to Ushahidi's crisis net, a new initiative they have. It's called Fire Hose of Crisis Data. And that leads to, so that they will know when people are asking for help or when people are going to offer help in the context of a particular crisis or disaster. And then I worked with some other practical things. For example, during the recent Indian election, the technical team of Narendra Modi, the person who became Prime Minister, worked with us asked fantastic questions that we got to learn exactly how people want to use this kind of stuff. So my assumption about how our social media analysis help did not exactly work the way they wanted us to use, and I'll be happy to talk about that. If you ask me a question, I'll go into a lot more detail on what we learned from that. But the most exciting thing is the latest project we have launched, which is working with United Nations Development Group on gender-based violence. A very major problem. You see the news all around, and very disturbing news. You see things in India and Nigeria and Pakistan and all these things. So we are working with them closely with the idea of understanding the violence against women, worldwide, with focus on Philippines, India, Nigeria, and South America right now, South Africa right now. But basically, it gives us very deep insights into the kind of problems, categorization, many, many other things. And that will allow us to present the data right to the policymakers. And hopefully, that will lead to some important policy decisions. And so on and so forth. You can, you know, this was another very exciting project, prescription drug abuse, online surveillance in epidemiology, where again we work with epidemiologists in our School of Medicine. And we do all kinds of NLP things with web forum data, very hard. When people who are abusing drugs and painkillers, the teletext is very hard to understand, right? You can imagine that. And here is an example of what we found. We found that people who were abusing certain kind of opioids were using loperamide, the Imodium AD kind of medication, in 10 to 20 times prescribed dose to manage the withdrawal side effect from the use of opioids. Right? So, and this was a true medical discovery because medical science, community did not know about it. Once we published work, we heard from doctors saying, "Oh, you're starting to see this kind of stuff." And that's very exciting. And some more things along that line. So we keep on doing that kind of characterizes. That should be enough. Please do feel free to ask questions, and as I think we have time available for conversations. All right. Now the next 5-6 slides I'm going to breeze through because none of you need any introduction here. So how much data? Massive amount, you guys know that, 10 times growth in a year in some cases. But here's an interesting thing, whether you know or not, just about 0.5% of all data gets analyzed, right? So there's all this data that is out there. In 2008, we surpassed the capacity to store the data that we produce. So being able to analyze the data is a very important thing. And I think this approach that we have, where we store all this data into and create massive data stores and go back to analyze, that will increasingly become outdated, right? Because we just can't store all the data, right? So you've got to find the data as it is being produced and create abstraction from that. This term abstraction is something I'll keep on coming back to in my talk. Now, the other interesting thing is the variety. So volume, my view, and not everybody may necessarily agree, my view is that volume is an easier problem to solve. Generally speaking, can throw computing power to solve the volume problem. The harder problem to solve is the variety problem. You have all different kind of data. And the issue here is that, and I've been working in data integration for a long time, since 80s. It goes back to that, in the days I used to work on so-called federated databases, and I used to work, visit this wing, database wing that is out there. I see Mohan in the thing, yeah, come many times when I was working database. One simple observation is that practically all variety problem or heterogeneity problem require a human involvement at some level. You just can't say, here is big data, here is my mining algorithm, here is my machine learning algorithm, give me some patterns and I'll look for it. This doesn't work that way. You really have to, for example, give some guidance on the mappings you might need or things of that nature. Another comment I would make is that vast majority of the work on integration, whatever that is, has been done with the unimodal data, data of the same modality. But nothing in the world really is same modality. You take any event, you take anything out there, you'll have photograph for that, you'll have the video for that, you'll have text for that, all kinds of different multimodal data will be there. And increasingly, we are, the system will become multisensory, as a human are multisensory. So how do you minimize human involvement, or how do you most effectively use human involvement in solving the variety problem is an important thing. Velocity is another major problem. I won't talk too much about it today, just a little bit later on. Here are just some of the questions that people have asked in the early days of this big data problem. And I'm sure many of you working in this area would have asked these kind of questions. And there are a huge amount of technologies. Okay? All kinds of technology, even the database technologies, you have relational database and this NoSQL and NewSQL and graph is again, you know, becoming extremely important right now, and so on and so forth. So the, all these technologies are there, that's fine. And there have been some, a decent number of success stories. So we've done something interesting. There was a recent article about the failure of Google flu trends, but in H1N1 they did a pretty good job at that time. And some of you may have seen the stories of the Nature article that came about the flu trend. But what is missing? And this is, I think, the crux of what I'm going to talk about. So, by and large, we have focused on business intelligence and targeted analytics need. And yet there are large number of challenges not yet addressed to serve complex individual and collective human needs. Right? So the examples would be empowered human in health, fitness and well-being, better disaster coordination, personalized smart energy, and many other things of that nature. So this is a huge underserved population of applications where I think there is legitimate and important and growing role of this big data, and that is what I'll come to. So there are many opportunities, many challenges. How do you create highly personalized, individualized, and contextualized? Now that may be in an industrial setting also. It may be that a port worker working in you know, logistics related to, or somebody working in logistics related to you know, containers and their shipping may need better latest knowledge to make the decision. So it may be individual making decision for business, but also the things that individuals do for their own interests and needs. Also to incorporate real world complexity in multimodal and multisensory nature of physical world and human perception. My own view is that no big data, more data just alone cannot be cannot solve your problem. You do need to develop better algorithms. My own view is that big data cannot replace the human judgment, as some of others have also said similar thing. Others feel that. Give me, remember that article a couple of friends, people I know well, have written on unreasonable effectiveness of big data. General idea was Alan Halaby and Raghu, yes, and general you know, thesis was give me all the, all your big data and we'll tell you what is all to know from the, that big data. Right? So I think that is that just doesn't work that way. I'll come to that more as I go along. So and the other important thing is that it's not just converting data into information that is sufficient. And what I underline and highlight is the need for actionable information. There's just so much data out there that also here's interesting thing for you to know. That is usually not what people are looking for. And remember, I'm not talking about people like you and I and technologies. I'm talking about a farmer. I'm talking about you know, a healthcare worker in the field. Okay. And so the important thing is that there's so much of the data, and I'll show you some real-world applications. The need is to convert that data into contextually relevant actionable information, something that they need to act upon at that moment. And that, going from information to actionable information, is the challenge. And that's where the semantics and the kind of stuff that I love to do really come into picture. So you can kind of go from data to information, but an action, you know, for example, that you suppose happen to believe in Apple a day keeps the doctor away, then what action you might take in that regard is very important. Now, you know, so in that context, I've been reading this interesting book and learning from, we do have a collaboration with cognitive scientists, but learning from, you know, things like this is something called, you might have heard about left brain and right brain. This is about bottom brain and top brain. And think about, so what it talks about basically is that we have this kind of process of learning from all the data that is coming in. And in computerized parlance, it will be like finding patterns, so mining or machine learning. And then we have these processes of top brain processes, which plans, which you know has applies a knowledge to say what are my options, which has the heuristics, which looks for options, things of that nature. And so that is more like the things we do with data and knowledge and the reasoning of that. And you know, unlike some people who say, you know, purely put all their faith in machine learning, or others who put all their faith in reasoning and declarative processing, I think what just the same way our brain, and as this kind of books discuss very well, combines all these things, we need to develop you know, solutions. Perhaps that these kind of solutions will be necessary for IBM's own vision in cognitive science and computing. We need to combine this you know, reasoning, this process in a very seamless way. So when you have this kind of thing, take this little example. We, of course, you know, all of you have heard about this Internet of Things. We will have sensors, of course, in refrigerator and everything, right? That will talk to the web or internet and will know that you alone Apple. And that, how do you take that information or data, whatever you want to call that, and then really tell you right at the time that you need to make a decision when you are at the grocery shop, that maybe you want to stock up on the Apple. So is that data, you having to go to your application and say, what is in my fridge? That doesn't work. Right? You don't want to go to grocery store and say, oh, give me all the data about all the things in my fridge. And then he said, no. The idea is to convert that into something that you can actually apply. And the interesting thing is that it's not even that simple. Yes, you may want to replenish with Apple, but you say, Apple is good, but Pear is also good, or something else is also very good. And I've been sick and tired of eating Apple all this time. Today I want something else. So human cannot be replaced, right? From all these things. How, you know. So the idea is that you have this contextual information that makes sense to human, not just to machines. We have probably the largest group in US in so-called semantic web, but I don't talk too much about that anymore, because we really apply semantic web a lot more than just work on listening. And the point here is that I'm not just interested in making machines understand and make machines smarter. But that is an issue of interest also, and I can understand its value, but I'm not actually interested in replacing humans either. I'm interested in making it easier and better for the humans. I think I saw this just walking in your lobby. Science and data for enhancing human capability, right? Something along that line. I think that's on the mark. So I want to have this information make sense to human and that's actionable for timely and better decisions. I call that smart data. Now it so happened that I wrote something about smart data when I had to give talk a keynote in 2011. And then I Googled and I found myself, my own article a while ago. So when I had this company, I had used this word smart data. At that point I used it to as a formulation of smart data strategy for providing services for search, explore, and notify. And then use ontologies and background knowledge and data reports to gain relevant insights. That's what I talked about. And you can see here, you have these ontologies or knowledge graph or things of that nature. It's really nothing very different. You have all kinds of heterogeneous data coming in. And you have all this semantically annotated data. And you guys work on annotation extensively, I'm sure, and I know. And then, with all that annotated data, you can do, you know, smart search or whatever else you want to do. Or find a pattern or find who knows what. Or who is the expert on the topic. All these things can be done when you have done that. So my 2013 retake was smart data makes sense out of big data. It provides value from harnessing all these V's, volume, velocity, variety, veracity, of big data, in turn providing actionable information to improve decision making. There's another take on that also, which is that smart data is focused on actionable value achieved by human involvement in data creation, processing, and consumption phases for human, improving human experience. And I talked about in 2008 something I call computing for human experience. The whole idea is that I'm really interested in not making, as I already said, machine smarter or even computer-human collaboration. Those are also interesting things. I'm most interested in how computers serve the human needs and to make human life better, to make human experience better, maybe health, maybe entertainment. So one way of looking at that is to think about this of human, by human, and for human. And so, for example, nowadays we have this data of human activities. So much data of human activities coming from the physical, you know, monitoring of physical activities, monitoring of activities on the web, monitoring of social activities. I could have near field communications, and then that would tell me you and I have met. In the topic on understanding stress for freshman medical students, I would measure the not just the sleep, but you know, and the physical activities and quantify itself, but I would also measure the social activities, how much time you spent meeting your friends during the day, right? I talked about physical, cyber, social computing in that context. So all your data of all these different types that are coming in, massive amount of data is being created. And being here in the Valley, you have seen probably the growth of all these devices company and the sensor companies and Internet of Things companies. And the biggest of these things, CES and SXSW, the two most important terms were, the hashtags were related to Internet of Things and personalized digital health, or digital health, right? So, and the second thing is by the humans. So humans are, you know, creating the data in an organized form. They put in the database, we can put it in the LinkOpen data. Humans collaborate on creating Wikipedia. This massive growth in this LinkOpen data, more and more data being published on the web for others to use in the context. So for example, during Hurricane Sandy, we had to look at the tweets that came from near a subway station that was allegedly flooded. Right? Because there can be tweets and there were a lot of problem with veracity, a lot of problem with people, you know, sending rumors and false information. So one way to handle that would be to say, did the tweet come from near? So is it likely that this is an eyewitness a record or observation of an eyewitness? And so then you will say, hey, it came from very, you know, within 100 meters of subway. And so the data for location of subway stations came from data published by New York City and put out on the web, right? So you're using that kind of data in understanding the, you know, other data, the tweet that is coming in, and addressing that kind of thing. And for the human, and this is the most important thing, so in the case of asthma healthcare application, we would have a detection of events such as wheezing sound and indoor temperature, or data rather, humidity and many other things. But really what matters is to give this kind of actionable information, or lead a human to make this kind of, you know, to come to this conclusion that close the windows at home during the day to avoid carbon monoxide in gush, to avoid asthma attacks at night. This is what is important. The reason that the quantified self and the reason that the Internet of Things as it is for the health, all these mobile applications, the reason that they will fail is because they create all the data. They will give you you know, how many steps you walk, but you take three of them and all of them give you different information. That's one thing. Secondly, so what? I walk 9,000 you know, steps or 11,000 steps. It doesn't tell me about how does it really impact my health. Is it sufficient? Did it change something about my health that I am concerned about? That really has to be brought into you know, our decision, our process, our decision making. So something that you can act upon, something that really matters to you. I take another example from the smart energy context. I can have so much data, electricity usage over a day, device at work, power consumption, cost kilowatt per hour, heat index, relative humidity, all this kind of data, right? And tweets and other things. What matters is this: washing and drying has resulted in significant cost since it was done during peak load period. Consider changing this time to night. And do that not when the difference is only 2% in saving. Because you know you're not going to change human behavior with 2% saving. Do it only if you understand that there's more than 10% saving is what might you know, lead the human to change his behavior. So these are the challenges that you have to do to lead from this data into actionable information. So here is the thesis that everyone and everything has big data now. It's the smart data that matters. So today, as much as time permits, and I'll give you some examples from these different spheres. I'll talk a little bit about ASTO application. Talk about crisis coordination in social media. I'll talk about a smart cities application. Let's look at asthma using our K health system. K stands for knowledge. So there's of course a lot of M health or M things, and this is a K health is a system that uses mobile computing, but also internet of things, so sensors and knowledge bases. To solve very specific problem. So here, collecting health observations, social perspective is that for a long time, disease were treated only by some external observations. Around 1885, things changed. We got stethoscope, and first, doctors started to take, external observations first beyond, external observations, observations from the body itself. In the last, just a very, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, things have changed, significantly. This thing is really going at a boggling speed. The amount of data that some humans are creating about their own physical activity is just significant. And I've been impressed. I've been monitoring from the start of this kind of movement, but the growth is simply something that I've seen in my own wildest dreams. So people are using all these kind of devices, and the amount of data that they are creating. In fact, until last 3, 4, 5 years, much of the healthcare data was created by patient interacting with the physician. Now, suddenly, in increasing number of cases, majority of the data has been created outside of any clinical enterprise, outside of your interaction with patient with the doctor. It's created under your own control by use of your own devices. This is something very significant. Some of you might have seen this. If you did not see this, let me recall the following. This gentleman is Larry Smart, professor of computer science at UCSD. And he is this quantified self buff. He himself diagnosed that he has Crohn's disease. He observed through his measurement that he has some inflammation in some body, somewhere in the body, and then as a smart guy, he read up literature and he came to conclusion he has Crohn's disease. And so he goes to doctor, not for diagnosis, but for treatment or management in this case. It's not a disease you can remove, but you can manage. So now Larry is a smart guy, and the point here is what Larry did for himself, a lot of knowledge that he has and can gain on his own. I expect this to be done for a common man, a common person, or anybody who doesn't have medical knowledge, who is not so savvy and going to the web and reading literature, medical literature, that the devices in the field will collect enough data that even a person in rural India would be able to have some help. And they can, of course, consult the doctor saying, can you please verify or something along that line. This is far different from telemedicine. If there is any confusion there, we have to discuss more about it. So, and then in the K-Health, what we want to do is, we want to, through physical monitoring analysis, now what we want to do is, we want to use our cell phone, our mobile phone, as the primary device to make this happen, right? Because for the first time in humanity, there is a device, a tool, that more than half the humanity has, right? Never in the entire history we had any tool that was available to more than half the humanity. This is the very first time that has occurred. And by 2017, smartphones will be the measure. Right now, cell phones are measured, by 2017, smartphones will be measured. So when everybody has this tool, why not use that? And that is an important implication, that I'm not going to use cloud computing as my vehicle for doing intelligent processing. I'll come to that later. So in the area of ADHF, it says $17 billion of the thing. 25% of the patients released from the hospital with the acute decompensated heart failure get back to the hospital, are readmitted to the hospital within 30 days, and 49% get readmitted within 6 months. Each readmission costs on the average $50,000, $8,000 to $10,000 a day of hospitalization, 6 days on the average. And of course, the cost on the human health and the suffering on the human health, right? And because I also deal with some business, and I'm not only a pure scientist, I look at the business issue, whether the time is right to work on that. Well, the Medicare, CMS, started to reduce reimbursement for rehospitalization for heart patients starting October 2013. Right? So the hospital themselves, who are just getting paid, they didn't care about human suffering, they were just getting paid by providing service. If the patient comes back, good, they will make more money. Now that won't happen. Now they have the incentive to solve the problem. So this was an important problem for us to work on. The other one that we are working on is asthma. 300 million people worldwide are affected by this problem, this disease, right? And it's all these statistics here. So for asthma, we have this kit. We have Sensodrome, we have, which has 9 inbuilt monitors. We have in the pulmonological diseases, doctors told us, none of these are something that I imagine or my students imagine. These are all done with the real clinicians. So they said, well, exhaled nitric oxide measurement is important, so we have this node sensor. But also we get data from pollen level data, from pollen.com, air quality data from AirEgg, air now, weather data, temperature, humidity, other data population, and we get the tweaks and other things in this domain. So with that, we have these personal level signals. We have public level signals coming from either hospitalization rate and other information like that. And we have population level signals. So think about it. You have this disease, very common disease, affecting so much, but you have so much data. And some of it is highly personal level data, and some of it is data that is relevant to everybody. But again, only the data near you is what matters to you. So it's again, even though it's a data out there in the web, data for pollen for you and me are different because you are interested in the pollen in this area and I'm interested in pollen in data, right? So that's something to keep in mind. And so if you think about it, this the data that is relevant to potentially solving the asthma problem is massive. It's a big data, truly big data issue, and especially big data in the sense of complex data issue. Right? Big data problems are bigger when the data is complex compared to when they are just simple type of data. And just as a, this is more of an academic slide, there are terms called cyber-physical, cyber-social, and physical-social, physical-social. And they can work in this kind of two of these things, more so in cyber-physical than other areas. But increasingly, real-world events are continuous, multimodal, multisensory, and observations span physical, cyber, social, all these three dimensions. So I am very interested in these rich these applications that involve this very rich kind of data. So in the case of asthma, for example, you have real-time health signals from personal level, public health, and population level arriving continuously in fine-grained samples, potentially with missing information, uneven sampling and frequencies, right? And then you have the challenge of understanding relationship between health signals and asthma attacks for providing actionable information, such as what risk factors influence asthma control, what is the contribution of each risk factor, is there anything, any alert for me today, before I step out of my home, things of nature, those nature. So you have, again, now this is kind of more of a high-level architecture. You have all the data acquisition and aggregation. Then this is the technological piece here. I'll come to these things very soon, IntelliGo and the event from social stream processing and risk models and things of the nature. And then what we want is this. We want to take medication before going to work. We want to say contact doctors. We want to say avoid going out in the evening due to high pollen levels. These are actionable information. That matters, highly personalized, highly personalized. Now, one important thing that we learned, and this is something we always believe, I've been interested in talking about semantics since 80s, is that you need to solve this problem, you really need to bring in domain knowledge. Just giving you data, just using the system, is not going to solve the problem. In this case, what is the knowledge? Well, the knowledge is the protocol, medical guidelines. How exactly does an asthma clinician who treats asthma solve it? So this is the clinical protocol. It uses asthma control level and severity level of asthma. And then in this case, if you have mild persistent asthma and it is not well controlled, the advice is, the guideline is to use medium inhaled corticosteroid. Right? So this is the medical knowledge that you have to bring into the system. And having brought that into the system, we have a system, I'll talk about it briefly, the semantic perception system, and the thing called IntelliGo, that uses domain knowledge and the reasoning and other algorithms that lead to something that makes sense to normal humans, non-clinicians, everyday person suffering from asthma, or the parent of a child suffering from asthma. So the other thing would be, so one thing would be here, diagnostic information, how well controlled is my asthma. Other computation of interest would be, how vulnerable is my control level today? Right? And we want to do this in the context of use of mobile phones, as I already mentioned that before. Now, to do this, it's not that straightforward that can I reduce my asthma attack at night kind of stuff would have to be transformed into another series of still complex problems, like what are the triggers? What is the visiting level? What is the exposure level over the day? What is the propensity towards asthma? What is the air quality indoors? The number of these things that have to be understood. The problem is very complex, right? And then you have all this data that I already mentioned, very complex piece of data. From there on, you have to connect with all these different things. That would then allow you to finally give the answer, right? And so that may lead to understanding of that particular correlation of luminosity during the day, carbon monoxide level goes up, and then understanding that you're keeping the doors open, leading to section 1 information. So here is the one level down into the processing. These are all the data I already talked to you about. All the data come in very, very different diverse forms. They're different manufacturers, they have different modality, right? So what is, before I can do any reasonable computation, I need to get that into some common form. This is exactly the same reason why you do annotation of the data, right? And here, I need to do semantic annotation of sensor data, and all the other data that is relevant, in fact. So I initiated a World Wide Web Consortium, a group on semantic sensor networking. So I co-chaired that group, and that came up with semantic sensor network ontology, and that is now practically a ad hoc standard worldwide adopted. Many systems have used that. And so here, what happens is that on one hand you have this ontology or domain model or whatever you want to call it, the ground knowledge of some sorts, acquired from public sources and experts, and so you can see the concepts that are relevant health signals. And then what happens is that all this data gets automatically annotated with the concepts that are relevant to that domain. So now your data is in a far more processable XML class or triple or RDF or graph format, right? That's much more amenable to processing with typed description. And so the data is using typing. That is defined using domain concepts. And from there, the computation will lead to understanding of this kind of stuff. So what we use is this semantic sensor networks, the group that founded. This idea here is to model the sensor. This is a generic model of a sensor. And from there on, this is the kind of high-level view of the ontology. So you can see the ontology is fairly deep. And there are a lot of interesting applications of this ontology. The idea is that, for example, we describe the sensors using this model, this ontology. Because we describe using that, we are able to drop in the sensor on the fly, meaning we are able to induce sensor dynamically into an application, right? Because the description is well defined, right? And there are many other things like that. You model the data, you model the sensor, you model the subsystem, you model the operating parameters, and many things of that nature. This ontology is complemented by the ontology or ontologies from the domain, right? Asthma-related things that I mentioned there. And what needs to happen here, and this is a very important slide, perhaps everybody knows that, but I think if not, this is very important, that you have raw data, a sensor user number, 150. It's a text, right, or some number. Then you can annotate that, and you can, you know, this is label data. And whatever we store the label data, you may have RDF, you may have some other things. Then you interpret this data and say this is high level elevated blood pressure. For example, you might have a diastolic value of 95, and NIH says anything above 90 for diastolic is is elevated blood pressure. That you say it's an elevated blood pressure. All this can be represented in the framework of the medicines network, but a doctor typically won't be able to give you medication based on symptom. It's not yet a diagnosis, right? And for that, you know, elevated blood pressure could be because of hypothyroidism or because of something else. That is very important. So you have to interpret this data, and this abduction coming to explanation as to why is this elevated blood pressure, and that is where the interlogo comes into picture. And that is then what you can do. So interlogo comes from this Greek word to perceive, and that basically this is very interesting. I had very successful students. Some of my most successful students have come from have not come from computer science. I mean, their undergraduate was not in computer science. Right? I had a guy who did bachelor's in statistics. He did computer science with me working in biomedicine, and he got hired in tenure track faculty position at Case Western University in School of Medicine. Right? So these are very interesting things. Now Corey Hansen, who worked on this, who is hired by IoT Labs at Bosch International, working on some very exciting things. His undergraduate degree was in cognitive science. So and in our work on cognitive, adaptive cognitive science or cognitive models, in this, you looked at this NACIS cognitive model of perception, just as a way of getting some ideas. Central role is played by prior knowledge. So you have the abductive part of the cycle, whereby low-level signals is converted into higher-level abstractions, and you can call that hypothesis building. And then you have the directive part of the cycle, you discriminate, whereby focusing attention on the aspects of environment that can provide useful information to pare down from among the possible explanations or hypotheses, to refine it and to further understand that. Now, brain is constantly doing that, always asking, you got some stimuli, an observation, you always ask question, using background knowledge, something to, what more I need to come to a particular conclusion, right? And here, prior knowledge comes, very important. In fact, it's indispensable. So using this SSN, we're able to represent the knowledge like that. These are the sensor-related stuff, and this is the factual information that goes in the knowledge base, right? So elevated blood pressure is probably 5,000, and then that these things are represented here as a bipartite graph, and sometimes that may not be good enough, rich enough representation. But the same exact thing can be done used for weather. Okay? So in that reasoning process, then we have this explanation kind of things going on. So act of choosing objects or events that best account for the set of observation you have, and I've already mentioned that. And then you might have something like what we call discrimination. So focusing attention on those aspects that provide useful information. And for example, there's a lot more machinery there. I'm kind of skimming through. There are papers published on all these things. More than happy to talk about later on. So for example, when I have clammy skin, then I'm able to say, oh, it's hypothyroidism, not hypertension, as an explanation for elevated blood pressure, which is what is important for me. Now, when we are done that, and here's the most important thing, here's a takeaway, that I don't want to play at the level of data. The amount of data is so large. Humans simply don't have the capacity or interest or desire to deal with all the data. So you need to convert all the data into in the small number of abstractions. This is called human perception. Right? So today, you will just imagine how much pieces of data in a computerized form would you be exposed to just in this talk. You have video kind of coming through your eyes, you have your speech coming, your text going on. Those will be massive number of, and you are going at much faster than 30 frames per second. And yet, if I ask you at the end of the lecture or talk, what did you get from that? All of you will be able to summarize in your own way. First of all, the summary and explanation, what you took away from my talk will be different. But they will all be relevant to you. And you will be describing them in one, two, or three topics, in one, two, or three sentences. Thus, you have the capability, each of us have the capability of converting this massive amount of data into few abstractions. This is what needs to be happening. This is what needs to happen continuously all the time. That this big data is there for everything of interest to us, our health and fitness and well-being and decisions in our work and all that. What the system has to do is to constantly convert this high amount, massive amount of data that is relevant, potentially relevant, into these few things that I should be bothered to pay attention to. Right? That is what is interesting. And now, we try to initially do this using this out reasoner. One interesting thing was that we decided that we are going to make all this thing done on a mobile platform. One of the simple reasons was that the examples I'm giving you, you may see, are health applications. There are HIPAA laws and privacy laws, and I didn't want to take a chance of putting the data on the cloud, right? It was just much easier for us to do IRBs. Facebook does not have to do IRB to check our emotions, but we have to do that in academia. I hope you guys have you heard the story about Facebook who did the experiments on emotions, right? So it was much easier to do that way. But then when you try to run this kind of computation on mobile phone, big problems. 15 nodes of knowledge base, it turns out, and asymptotic complexity. So one option would be we send the data on the cloud and to use massive computing resource. Not a great idea. Other is to downscale semantic processing such that each device is capable of reversing perception. We call it intelligence at age. First point is that healthcare data privacy issues. I just don't want to send it on the on the cloud because that would require more care and to the IRB that indeed you are keeping patient privacy. And philosophically, I want all the data and everything to be under control of patient and not just go out. It's much easier, and more clean solution in our case. And the other important thing is that think about it. I want to build this solution to be deployed in a rural India case. Communication is bandwidth is limited. There will not be there. If I can do much of the communication right on my mobile devices, my solution is far more scalable. Scalability in terms of deployment and options. Right? Maybe of course technically I can talk about in some other applications a synergy between some person here and some person in the cloud. So we can certainly talk about those things. That is the thing, and so we came up with B-factored encoding and their operations to both encode prior knowledge and execute semantic reasoning, and that allowed us to actually go from tens of nodes to thousands of nodes, time reduced from minutes to milliseconds, and complexity growth from terminal to linear. So that's an interesting little bit of a side thing. So takeaway here would be translate low-level data into high-level knowledge or abstractions. Prior knowledge is key to the perception, problem for perception, and intelligence of the age allows us to scale massively and gives us very good you know, way for deploying those solutions. So coming to the second topic, second example, social media analysis, coordination, crisis coordination using our Twitter platform. Here, particularly we've been interested in the social good, you know, smart data for social good. So we want to mine human behavior to help societal and humanitarian development, crisis response for coordination, harassment on social media, gender-based violence, and things of that nature. I'm going to take the example of crisis coordination. Take the example of Hurricane Sandy. Even though it came towards the end of 2012, it was the second most discussed event on Facebook. 20 million tweets with Hurricane and Sandy keywords in the first week. Right, so really large amount of data. And so we used a Twitter system that we developed and the various keywords here. What is interesting about Twitter is that and in long genesis of this thing is some work we did with IBM and Microsoft Research. With IBM, we had gotten a few years ago, now it's been quite some time that we got, but this is UIMA, UIMA award we had gotten, and in fact, Mina, who is not today here, she had an appointment, worked on that. And we also worked with IBM on the Dan Grohl and all those guys on the BBC Sound Index stuff, right? So that was a follow-on to the work in the Web Fountain. And it was very interesting, right? What are the tweens in London talking about? Oh, that is there. So it was a very exciting project. So we did some work there, and then we worked with Microsoft Research on advertisement issues, how you can intent detection from the post so that you could improve the targeted advertisement. We found that the result would be 6 to 8 times better than the Twitter-based techniques that they were using. But the Twitter is significant because it can do spatio-temporal thematic, people, content, network, sentiment, emotion, intent, and more of that analysis. So there's a little bit of tweet here, and yet so many dimensions to understand. And first of all, you know, it's not just 140 characters, there's 2K of the packet that you can have, all the metadata. But, you know, humans construct the tweet and they convey so much through a tweet, right? So it's pretty interesting thing to do. I won't go into much of the social media analysis here today, but I'm interested in actionable. The actionable thing here that I'm interested in is timely delivery of right resources and information to the right people at the right location. That's and because everybody wants to have, but they don't know how. So here's an interesting insight from some data analysis. During Oklahoma tornado, we got 2 million tweets during the first 48 hours. And analyzing these tweets, we found that only 1.3% of those tweets had precise resource donation request to help. And only 0.02% of those had precise resource donation offers to help. Here is an example of requests and examples of offers. And this is important, only if you match the requests of help with the offers that you actually are achieving some purpose, right? So matching this, and then of course you have to match based on location, type of request, needs, and so on and so forth. If you don't, then you can create second crisis. At Hurricane Sandy, you had so many clothes that actually created a second disaster, right? So you want to be able to match. Where do I go to help out from volunteer work around the moon? Anybody knows, I would like to volunteer today. Help is desperately needed in Swanee. Or if you like to help, call that number. Right? So matching that these things are, one thing can respond to another one on the fly is very important. It is this capability that we provide as a service that has been integrated to Ushahidi's crisis net. That's very exciting, I think. There's something called continuous semantic. This is the part that deals with velocity. So here the idea is that think about any event. None of the events are going to play out exactly as they are defined in the beginning, right? So you take things change. the topic of conversation changes. Hurricane Sandy, initially before it lands, you're going to talk about some things. While it is going, taking out the trees and electricity, there's another set of conversation. And then what happens, you do not know ahead of time, there are different things. It takes different path than originally anticipated, and the conversations are totally different things. So things change. So if you started, let's say, getting on Twitter, filtering using some hashtags and keywords, it's not going to really capture everything there is to be known. The crisis, in this case, has different topics. How do you automatically figure out those new things, and how do you do smart filtering so that you can source new content for the crisis as it evolves? Take an example. We used to monitor 2009 Iran elections, and there are a lot of things about the green, people with the green flags and other things. Ahmadinejad and Rafsanjani and all those things. And suddenly there was this event of Neda, the young girl that was gunned down. And there was a significant different conversation. And now Neda was nobody that you knew about that particular action. And suddenly that becomes a very important entity and something that you need to understand as a part of monitoring that event. So for that, then what we do here is this life cycle. We have a system called Wartel that does a semantic processing on streaming data. And that would give us a bunch of entities or key phrases or to focus on. Using that, you can create this cloud. And then we have built a system, a tool called Loser. It will take a bunch of keywords and mine Wikipedia to automatically create a domain model. So I remember this is relevant to 29th of January 2011. That is the day before Million Person March in Egypt, during the Egypt Revolution. And then there is suddenly discussion about Heliopolis. How would somebody like me know? I don't have intimate geographic knowledge of Egypt, right? So here, this model tells me that Heliopolis is a suburb of Cairo. So my system now has more knowledge to work with and understand and classify the content and so on and so forth by applying this knowledge to the piece like that. So that is the work on continuous semantics. You can Google continuous semantics and you'll get to the page and all work on that here. The last one I will briefly talk about is smart cities. And the application is, of course, well-known traffic management. But the interesting thing about this one here is that we combine both social and sensor data and the background knowledge. So to improve everyday traffic integral to our most common problem of stuck in traffic. And of course it's a big problem, billion cars by 2020, but just a 20% increase in the number of cars led to 236% jump in, 20% jump in population led to 236% jump in traffic. Right? So, big problem, right? And the data is from IBM Smart Traffic Insight. So here's a problem. To understand this, we took 3 months of data from San Francisco. Every minute update of speed, volume, travel time, occupancy resulted in so many link status observation. We went to 511.org. We found the 738 active events and 146 scheduled events. And there were, of course, a lot of problems and challenges with the data. And so again, you can see the volume, velocity, all those problems. And the questions would be like this: can we detect onset of traffic congestion? Can we characterize traffic congestion based on events? Can we estimate traffic delays in a road network? Right. So this, we are part of FP7, EU's FP7 program. Here are some of the partners, including some of the cities, Arras and Brasov and. And such, here's a very interesting thing. It was also something I was not expecting. We were able to find extensive amount of data. These are all city departments in different colors, right? For example, this is social programs department, this is department for healthcare in city government. And we were able to find tweets that relate to each of these different topics, departments, and such. So this, we validated this extensive amount of social data available that are relevant to decision making related to city and smart city projects and smart issues. So our architecture looks something like this. You have tagging and some NER. We have these locations. We have the SCAD ontology from IBM's Smarter City work. So, and then we have file level hierarchy. So these are things that we don't knowledge. And then these are the kind of stuff that you want to do with instance in any section. And on the way, we have to solve some interesting problems. For example, you know, not focus on Half Moon and Half Moon Bay and Brewing Company, but the whole thing, Half Moon Bay Brewing Company, is the most relevant entity here, appropriate entity here. And I think anybody who does learning would know, would kind of intuitively understand that CRF is the appropriate choice to you know, deal with these larger and grand problems. So that kind of stuff happened. But then, ultimately, when we combine the processing of sensor and social streams, we're able to find complementary information. For example, slow traffic from sensor data and accident from textual data. That means, sensor could not tell me why the traffic is slow, but the social data told me the traffic is slow because of accident there. Right? So that is very good. Because very often, think about automatically taxonomy generation from textual data. Problem is labeling the nodes. How do you label the nodes, right? That same kind of, humans are much good at labeling the nodes. They have the natural language. Corroborative, so you can get additional confidence. For example, accident event supporting an accident report from the ground truth. Or timely, so knowing poor visibility before formal report from the ground truth about slowing of the traffic because of the visibility problem of fog or things like that. So here, some more examples. Usually you can see complementary events and corroborative events from these different sources. And then you can work towards larger things like how issues in the city can be resolved. Like what should I do when I have fog conditions? What has happened in the past? What has been the lead time between fog detection and actual slowdown? What diversions have worked? What advisories have worked? Many things on the website is what we need to work on. All right, so there is a takeaway here. Big data is everywhere, at individual level, not just the level of company and corporations and big organizations, that with growing complexity, and I did not get talk enough about it, and I would also admit that we need to do more concrete work with multi-sensory, multi-modal data. We've done some. But there's a lot more to be done there. I think that's a very challenging, exciting research area. But we are, I gave you an example of physical psychosocial computing, data of all this kind. I think it's a very exciting next set of problems to solve. Analysis is not sufficient. Right? In fact, nobody cares about data, nobody cares about analysis. What can I do? What decision can I make? How does it affect me? That is what is going to, that is what somebody will pay for. That's very important for us to understand. Bottom-up techniques, a technique is not sufficient, or set of bottom-up techniques are not sufficient. We need also need top-down processing, and what background knowledge is extremely important in bridging these together and doing the reasoning necessary. Focus on human and improve human life and experience. That is exciting thing. That's the that is the reason for talking about the smart data. Data to information to contextually relevant abstractions. Actionable information meaning value of data. That is the value part. The five V's that you talk about. The value is be able to take action. To assist and support humans in decision making. And so, you know, big data challenges without intention of deriving value is generally without goal. There are some more things. Noesis has a pretty extensive website. You can look at the vision and number of things that we talked about. And really exciting things to work with a lot of companies. About 100 researchers, about 45 PhD students. All PhD students are funded. The interesting things that we work on, some very exciting real problems out there. All right.
we still have about less than 20 minutes for questions. So, for us, open questions.
I can give a lot of demos if you're interested, if it's online. Yes.
I have a question. At one point you mentioned summarization. And I'm just interested. I know that's an interest of like Rob High, who's our CTO, but the Watson Division talks about, you know, how to summarize meetings. How do you measure, how do people measure a high quality summarization? Do you have any insights into that? So if you were to take your talk and each of us could generate a summarization, how would we rank order those summaries?
We're actually doing summarization. Sujan, do you remember exactly the work on summarization? We have a project called Social Health Signals, and we're working with Mayo Clinic on that, and we have access to a lot of Mayo data. This is to understand the consumers' healthcare surge and things, and particularly we're focusing initially on major depressive disorder kind of stuff also. But I think at this point of time, we might have unfair advantage in that when you so let me paint a scenario as to what we are planning to do or trying to do or expect to do is that when you Cleveland Clinic, Mayo Clinic, these are WebMD, these are major healthcare sites, so they have literally millions of queries a day, just like any search engine can look at the results and measure things, you can do the same thing there. And when the search is there, you are trying to get a sense of what users are interested in. And you are even trying to change their behavior. For example, a lot of people search on diagnosis and treatment, and very few search on prevention. But the medical establishment is totally clear that prevention is the most important thing that you will do. So in the results, you could start giving them, because you understand the topic, you understand the results could be related to diagnosis, treatment, prevention, all kinds of stuff, or procedures, that you would adjust the results, and then you can, of course, measure the clicks that you have. Now, in the same kind of environment, you can give a summary of the things as to why, what is it, what is the relevance of that result. So in the days of Tali and my company, we used to call rich media objects, meaning the object that is relevant to the query or search or browsing, we give the description of all the stuff, which is exactly what you see today in Google's result of that. They call it, something else. There, clearly, you don't want to give the whole Wikipedia page, right? Even if you've got the entire thing, so you're going to summarize something. Right? And that would, of course, involve a lot of different things. One thing would be all the queries on that particular topic, generally that user has asked, let's say depression. Or you would also try to understand the categorizations that we understand of this disease. And then you summarize, so it's very clear.
I should let others ask questions, but what I was looking for is like data compression is a well-defined thing. Summarization isn't so well-defined because of something you said, which is everybody has different knowledge. So what's a good summarization for one person may not be a very good summarization for another person.
So it is personalized. It has to be personalized eventually, although it can be accepted. Yeah.
Some of us have been looking at the use of sort of first principles of simulation models as a way of encapsulating both prior knowledge and abstractions, and combining that with techniques such as stochastic optimization to channel that knowledge towards making decisions. So the goals seem very, so this is like super top down, I guess, in your setting. One example is data simulation techniques to combine, say, sensor data with an agent-based model of drivers. Right? The IBM Kyoto lab has done a simulation of every car in Kyoto. So one question was, have you sort of looked at that, those sort of aspects of the
that looks a rather refreshing idea. So certainly we should think more about that. I don't know, but it sounds intriguing.
I'll sort of add to that, to Jim's point or your point about the role of the person's knowledge. And thus it struck me with a number of your examples that the level of advice that you want is very different depending on who the individual is. And maybe that's really easy to see in the traffic example where today Google leaves, Google will give me the map of the traffic and will show me where the accidents are, and they are reported from the social media, right? So it just does that. And then you're on your own. And if you're an expert in the area, you know enough to get off at the next exit because you know there's another route, and Google will immediately start plotting you on that other route. But if you're not and you're scared, you stay the course or whatever, right? But how do you take these ideas that you have and turn them into kind of more of a partnership with the human so they can adjust to what the human knows? And or is there a way to do that? We're kind of interested in this notion of the computer not as our advisor but as our assistant here. And so how do we leverage all the cool work you're doing to get us better help with this assistance?
This is a fantastic question. In fact, I have another talk on computing for human experience, and I looked at this whole thing about replacing human to machine being pure an assistant, and many different people have talked about it. Werner Bosch to Minsky and people others. And I'm very interested in understanding the synergy between humans and the machine. But to tell you the truth, this has kept our hands free. So I have talked about it at a vision level in the talk on computing for human experience, and I have a paper on that. But in terms of doing concrete work, I haven't done anything that right now this asthma problem is actually being deployed. I mean, we are giving this kit to, the pediatrician is giving kit to parents of children that have asthma. But at what point of time I will really understand the parents' knowledge of asthma and factor that in? I've not gotten there. Because again, to make that progress, I will really need a lot more data about the human behavior and what he has done or she has done in the past. I painted a number of real problems we worked on, but none of them have afforded us a real model of the human. So it's something I think we need to do, and the research really interesting.
I was just going to say, Mateo back there, Italy, he's been working on looking at people's emails to try to build a model of the person, the individual user based on emails. And to your point about not wanting the data in the cloud, we don't want to send the email data to the cloud, even though it may start there if it's in, some cloud based account. But we want to make sure that it's local. And I think email is probably the best thing I can think of right off the hand.
I was gonna say in the traffic example, Google knows. It knows how many times you've veered off the highway. It knows everything that about your behavior because it could track that data and build models from it. Could it use it? Could it learn to use it in a way that's assistive and not just plain spooky?
Yeah.
Right?
So, creepy.
I'm not totally sold on any one way of accessing data, because what is the relevance of email with that person's decision on his child's asthma? I don't know.
Yeah.
So I believe that in the context of some office decision making, you might be able to create some knowledge. And I'm aware of other efforts also. I think I was a good friend of mine did a startup in that area of analyzing emails and creating some models from that. But for application, our lives are fairly segregated. what we do at office, what we do with our spouse, what we do with our child, other external professional things. We bring in load pieces of knowledge and different behaviors for each of them.
Different user model for every role.
Yeah.
So,
right. Right. So any one, you know, generally techniques to be able to do that. In that example I gave you about Tahir Square and you know, automatically creating a model for that particular situation, that kind of things can come handy, because that's what, you know, you talked about creating something on image. I created that from extracting entity from Twitter tweets, and you know, then going to Wikipedia and then creating a model that seemed to be relevant to those collection of tweets, right? So that kind of techniques would come handy. But then which one you apply in which context would be another problem, and then how effective they are is something we don't yet know. But much of this will come about, in my view, at least the way I work, is that I really look for really good use case or scenario. And for the problem that you just asked, which is really also near to my heart, I haven't found one yet. For example, in the depressive disorder issue, these users are anonymous. I don't have access to that. I can understand their certain behavior, what results they will get, but I don't know them intimately. I have no way to influence giving them more other than just seeing this, showing them different results. I can certainly show them different results. Just say Facebook would show different schemes of emotions. But the point here is more. The other thing is, it is unclear to me that the effort it might take to create understanding of that particular human in depth might pay off. It may not pay off. That we may want to keep it at a shallow level, because at the end you still are going to rely on human intellect. And think about it, the search, right? The search is working only because of the, you know, human brain is looking at the results and picking the one. You know, if you
human is taken out of that. Models is for education applications. We want to know what the student knows, and help them plan their career.
That is one of the better examples, because the domain is better defined. Yes. You have the grade material, you have the expected outcome that you have. It's a number of things you can constrain. Yes. And yes, so that is that will be.
On behalf of IBM Research and Assorted Stuff, I want to say thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Amit has a busy schedule, so he will be staying on up until 1:15 p.m. So because of that, we are arranging an open lunch meeting with him in J2601. So you're welcome to come to the lunch. So we'll have